would imagine monitoring patients is different for each of the MPNs. So how are patients typically monitored over time? And let's start with essential thrombocythemia.
Yeah, I think, again, it's similar, you know, what's near term, what's long term. And so in all of these diseases, thrombosis risk is a near term risk. That's something that I am monitoring in certain ways to help mitigate that risk. In ET and PV, I approach them similarly. Blood counts are certainly, you know, these are diseases of the blood forming system. Certainly monitoring blood counts I find helpful. But the reality of it is in ET, there is not a clear linkage between blood counts and risks. And so I like to keep the platelet count near normal if I can. But I also recognize that it may not be worth suppressing all of the blood counts to achieve that landmark, because it's not clear that that's really reducing the risk any more than just having somebody on a medication that helps control the blood counts. In polycythemia vera, you know, different blood counts are very important. The red blood cells are kind of like part of the clotting risk. We know from clinical trials that keeping the red blood cell parameters within certain ranges reduces the risk of clotting. So what I monitor in polycythemia vera is the hematocrit. In women, I like to keep it below 42. In men, I like to keep it below 45. But I don't just, you know, I'm not a slave to the hematocrit. I am keeping an eye on the other blood counts and the other red blood cell parameters. So for instance, what's the size of the red blood cells? You know, that tells me a little bit about what's going on in the blood formation for that patient, and what's the number of red blood cells. So sometimes people can have very small red cells because they're a little iron deficient and have a huge surplus of the number of red blood cells. And that tells me a little bit about how their blood forming system is responding to therapy. Iron deficiency in polycythemia vera is very prominent. I personally believe it's a major driver of symptoms who are in patients who are receiving phlebotomy as part of their care. And it's something that I monitor and really counsel patients on. My goal is to make people phlebotomy independent. But it can take a while. Everybody starts out iron deficient, and then we take iron out of their body through blood, you know, with blood, with the phlebotomy, and that makes them more iron deficient. I monitor symptoms from patients. And, you know, sometimes that can tell me that their disease needs to be, their treatment needs to be tweaked a little bit. Even something as simple as aspirin, you know, people can sometimes have burning in the skin or itching that is sometimes responsive to changing the aspirin dose or how it's given once a day versus twice a day. And, you know, that simple thing can be a big change for a patient who's kind of, you know, literally climbing out of their skin or wishing they could, and to try and find something that is helping. And I know I'm kind of going a little bit long, but I would say one other thing is I see patients for a very long time. Right. So I can follow patients I'm getting old enough now that I've followed patients for decades. And when things are going well, I don't see my job as being over. I see them more than any other physicians. Like I had a patient the other day at COVID. I said, oh, you should probably get this medication. Do you have your primary care physician? You know, who's taking care of you? And he goes, well, to be honest with you, you're my guy. And so, you know, it's like, it's true. I see this patient a lot. And so, you know, sometimes they forget if I'm not paying attention to their blood pressure, you know, the risks or treatment of diabetes, cholesterol, lipids, you know, their screening programs for mammogram or colonoscopy, you know, health maintenance issues. I do keep an eye on that in patients because I do think it's a part of the MPNs. I think that there are excess risks for patients for some of these factors. Certainly, you know, if you think of it as three strikes, you know, they get a strike for having an MPN. I don't want them to have any other strikes. So diabetes, hypertension, those are strikes that I can potentially at least treat or refer them to somebody to help with co-manage with me. And so that's kind of my general approach.
What about patients who have myelofibrosis? Are they monitored more closely?
You know, I think it depends a little bit on the patient. Patients with early myelofibrosis often don't have any symptoms or near-term risks much different than those from ET or PV. As the disease can progress, then some of these patients have, you know, more profound problems with symptoms, which I may be trying to find a solution to make them feel better. And also blood counts can become more of an issue. Transfusions in some patients or a very high white blood cell count. You know, the spleen is often quite enlarged, although in my experience, most patients aren't really bothered by the size of their spleen as much as the physicians are. It is something where I think on average, they're monitored a bit more closely, depending on the patient.
What happens if someone suddenly has a change in blood counts? What do you do?
Yeah, I mean, repeat it. That's the first thing. Also check what's going on. It's not uncommon in patients with MPNs that, you know, I'll see them and the counts are, you know, a little bit out of whack. The white count is much higher than it's been. And, you know, and questioning them like, oh, yeah, I had X, Y, or Z last week or the week before. They had a, you know, it used to be a URI, upper respiratory tract infection, or they had, you know, a minor surgical procedure. And sometimes the responses to these things can be accentuated in patients with MPNs. And so, you know, if that's what's part of this story, you know, I certainly would repeat it and let things calm down a little bit. And that's often all it is. I'm a much more of a monitor of the trends. So, you know, one-time measure doesn't generally excite me. It may make me want to have a follow-up a little bit more in a shorter period of time. Of course, it depends on what the change is. But for most of the changes that we observe, they're, you know, relatively minor. And I will monitor them over time. If I see a trend where something is progressively increasing or decreasing over time, then I start thinking about what else is going on. And that's always in the context of what's going on with the patient. How are they feeling? What's their physical exam like? What are the other laboratory values like?
When is a bone marrow biopsy necessary?
I would say a bone marrow biopsy is absolutely necessary at the time of diagnosis. I personally do not routinely monitor by bone marrow biopsy unless it's part of a clinical trial. But I do perform a bone marrow or want to look at the bone marrow morphology if there is one of these changes or at least a, you know, a trend that I want a little bit more information about. And so if it's been a very long time since somebody has had a bone marrow. You know, if it's been 5 or 10 years, and sometimes I may recommend we look just so we can collect a little bit more up-to-date information. But I don't routinely do a bone marrow, but I will do it if there are laboratories that are kind of trending in the wrong direction. There's symptoms or physical findings that I'm just not sure about. And I think it would help me be more sure as to what's going on and be able to discuss that with the patient. Sometimes just to say, hey, look, you know, we were worried about this, but the bone marrow looks really good.